Hello and welcome to today's meeting of Democrats of Greater Tucson. My name is Larry Bodine and I'm the president. I'll be your host today. Democrats of Greater Tucson has been around since the 1970s, and we remain the only forum of Democrats that meets every week. And this is the place to find out about candidates and issues and to commune and enjoy the company with Democrats. Marco, give us a wave for those of us who've just joined late. How are you today?
Good. Thank you, Larry. Nice to be here.
I'll come back to you in just a second, Marco. What we want to do is cover just a few announcements. Why don't we get started with the indomitable Kathy Ramage White, who is our membership director. Tell us about why people should join DGT.
You should join DGT because that's where all the great Democrats hang out, of course. Welcome, everybody. I know many of you, if not most of you, are already a member. But if you're not a member, remember, it's only $20. That gives you a full year's membership. So that's quite a deal. It kind of reminds us of PBS. You know, it's here and anybody can watch it. But to really be involved, you need to be a member. So we sure hope all of you will join, but you join DGT, go on to DGT.org. Right back to you, Larry.
All right. Thank you so much, Kathy. Let us turn to our board member, Susie Anderson, to tell us about the programs that we have coming up. Go ahead, Susie.
Hi there. Next week on June 28th, we have Diane Neville, who is the chair of LD10 Democrats, and she's going to speak to us about those local issues. Then on June 29th at 4 to 6 p.m., we've got our Drinking Democratically Happy Hour at the Augustine Kitchen, July 5th at noon. We have Miranda Lopez, who is the new director for Pima County Democratic Party, and she graduated from the UA in Tucson in 2018 with a double major in Spanish and political science. So it'll be really interesting to hear from her. And then we have one of our candidates, Andres Cano, who is in my LD, he's my representative, and he's just an awesome young man and working against great odds up there. So that's it for our schedule events.
Thank you so much, Susie. That was great. A lot to look forward to. Let me turn now to Christina Early. You know, Democrats of Greater Tucson are meeting in person now at Happy Hours, and we have a happy hour coming up, Drinking Democratically. Tell us all about it, Christina.
Hi, everybody. 1 week from tomorrow will be our second Drinking Democratically from 4 to 6 p.m. I'm at Augustine's Kitchen downtown in the Mercado, just west of I-10 there on Congress. We do ask that you register. It's no cost. We just need to know how many people are coming, and so far we have 29. So come on, folks. The Augustine Kitchen is providing the banquet room for us to use, which is just off of their patio dining area. And if you're interested in having dinner there, we do recommend that you go ahead and contact Augustine Kitchen directly and make reservations, because it is a very popular spot and they fill up quickly. Might be nice to have some great political conversation with your fellow Democrats and then go ahead and have dinner there at this locally owned restaurant. So I hope that y'all will register, click that link. It's easy to do. Check the website for more information. Thank you very much. I hope to see everybody there next week.
It's going to be a great event, and I look forward to seeing everybody. It's just one of the things that is so pleasant. You're face-to-face with Democrats and people who are of like mind. And with that now, let me introduce our speaker. Marco Lopez is running for governor in the Democratic primary. He is an international business consultant. He's the former mayor of Nogales, elected at age 22, right out of college. He is the former director of the Arizona Department of Commerce, appointed by Governor Janet Napolitano, and he was chief of U.S. Customs and Border Protection during the Obama administration. In 2011, Marco started his own business to bring investments to the U.S. His work has brought high-speed internet to low-income families, closing the digital divide. Marco says his campaign is going to focus on three issues: education, jobs, and access to health care. And with that, Marco, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Larry, and thank you all very much for the opportunity to talk to you and be with you today. It was a warm morning when I left Phoenix, and it's a little cooler here in Tucson where I'm at today. Look, I think as I look at my parents' journey as immigrants to Nogales, always believing in the promise of Arizona, that if you worked hard and you had access to quality education, and you treated people, with respect, that you could get ahead and get along in Arizona. And that was certainly the case for me. I watched my dad as a small plumber grow his company every single day, working very hard to be sure that me and my two sisters had what we needed at home. And my mom, also a small business owner there in Nogales. Today, she still has her small bed and breakfast and is on the city council in Nogales. But I went on to the University of Arizona, graduated, and put my education and my belief of working hard for others to practice. Was elected, as you said, Larry, mayor of the city. Got reelected with 78% in 2002. And was then asked by then Governor Napolitano to go work in the governor's office in Phoenix, which I did starting in 2004. And eventually worked my way up in the administration, becoming the director of the Arizona Department of Commerce. Then in 2009, President Obama appointed me to be the chief of staff at Customs and Border Protection. CBP, as it's known, is the largest law enforcement agency in the country with a budget of $15 billion and 60,000 employees, focused here in Arizona on securing the border between the ports, but mostly investing in technology to make sure that our ports of entry were working properly. Because we know that in Arizona, $16 billion of trade depends on our ports working, providing over 180,000 jobs for Arizonans, all the way from Southern Arizona to Northern Arizona. And so now have been in the private sector for almost 10 years. In September, I was first invited to be part of the solution, finding a solution to our 56% of low-income households not having access to broadband. The Carlos Slim Foundation hired me to put together a plan that today has connected over 900,000 homes in America, a little over 11,000 here in Arizona. The program is called Connect to Compete, where children who are in the free and reduced lunch program can have access to $10 a month broadband that would cost normally $50 to $60, depending on where in the state you live, sometimes maybe even more. But I'm now more certain than ever that those opportunities that were available to me and my family in Nogales are so much more difficult to attain for Arizona families because we continue to underinvest in education, 49th or 48th, depending on who's counting. Either way, we're last. We have over 700,000 people in Arizona that still don't have access to quality healthcare. And finally, if we want to compete regionally for the jobs of the future, we need someone who has actually created jobs and understands that our economy, in order to compete, needs to diversify. And we need to make the investments in education so that we have quality workforce that provides opportunities for all families, not only now, but in 10 to 15 years from today. So I'm excited to be here with you all today. I will continue to constantly be in Southern Arizona. I've committed to making sure that all 15 counties And all 22 tribes are part of my campaign and will be part of my administration when I do have the privilege of serving as your governor here in Arizona. So with that, Larry, I'm happy to take questions or go into detail in any of the programs that you might all be interested in today.
What's your opinion of the efforts by Governor Ducey to radically change the tax system so that it nullifies Prop 208, which was the Invest in Ed proposition?
Well, first of all, it's unacceptable. I think the will of the voters in Arizona is clear. The investments in education are needed. And so his efforts to undermine that effort and the will of the voter are unacceptable. And I think that the court, for the most part, has found that that case in that he's brought and his rich colleagues have brought against 208 is failing. And now he's looking for a backdoor solution. As a bull, what I'm clear about is that Arizona Democrats need to play offense. For far too long, we've played defense, not only Democrats here, but in the country as well. And what I mean by that is, every day for 3 years, when I woke up, my first briefing was at 7 a.m. when I was head of Customs and Border Protection. It was an intelligence briefing. And my briefers sat in the room and told me the happenings overnight of some of the most pressing issues needed to be addressed. And I had to make a decision. I had to make a decision there and then. And what I knew then was that if the bad guys were playing offense and we were playing defense, we were losing. And for far too long, I think Arizona Democrats have been playing defense. And so I'm excited not only on the tax issue that you raised, but on issues of education, of jobs, and of healthcare. I'm interested in playing offense, and that's what you will see as your governor. Playing offense, long-term, solving the solutions and the problems that we need in this state.
Barbara Warren has a question. Go ahead, Barbara.
Hi, Barbara.
Hi. I actually have two questions. Maybe that's cheating, but one is, it's hotter. It's hotter than ever. Fires are burning more than ever. Our whole country is experiencing all these changes in our climate. What exactly do you want to do specifically to address climate change and turn all this around in our state? And the other things is, what specifically do you want to do about healthcare?
Thank you. So Barbara, on the issue of water and fires, I'm on the board of the Nature Conservancy. I've been on that board for a little bit over 2 years. And one of our main strategies of foreign forest restoration is making sure that we put pressure on the federal government to thin out our forests, to make them healthy, because it helps both us being on the offense on forest fire season here in Arizona, but it's directly tied to the runoff of our snowmelt in the winter from northern Arizona that helps the San Pedro and 48% of the valley in Maricopa County depends on that runoff. And so we've got to make the investments and we've got to lead from a position of knowledge and power in our efforts with the federal government, because that's really who controls the forest strategy in northern Arizona, but everywhere that you see a lot of these fires burning today. It's no surprise. It happens every year. What is not acceptable is that we keep coming and talking about fire safety and preservation after the fact. And so we've got to be sure that those investments are being made. And you will see me aggressively working to push for funding to thin out the forest. I think previous senators have worked with the Nature Conservancy and others to promote that. And you will see me as a champion to do that, because it's tied directly, again, to our water health. On your second question was about
Could I just ask, I was specifically asking what you want to do about climate change.
Yeah, so on climate change, I think it's directly related to our growth. And so we need industry here in Arizona that focuses on renewables. We shouldn't be there's no reason why we're not the solar capital of the country and maybe even the world, but we haven't had an emphasis on that. So climate change is obviously real. And so we've got to be sure that we're making the investments in renewable energy to lead us in the direction of solar and renewable energy production here in the state. Because I think that that's where we can be more most effective. But it requires industry investment, and we've got to be the leader in that, Barbara. Your second question. Remind me again.
Healthcare.
So the 700,000. So 11.1% of our population doesn't have access. What I've been working with the leaders of our healthcare systems, specifically at the University of Arizona in Phoenix and Banner Healthcare and Equality Healthcare, is a model that we see in Colorado, where Banner up there actually has partnered with the federal government to make sure that there are federal qualified health centers in each one of the counties. And that's what we need to do here. And that is partnership with the federal government. The industry here has refused those partnerships. So it requires leadership from the state level to bring both a private sector and the federally qualified medical center agency together to provide that level of care throughout Arizona. So that's what we need to do immediately to try to begin to close that gap of 700,000 of our residents, Barbara.
Susie Anderson has her hand up. Go ahead, Susie.
Hi, Susie.
Hello, Marco. It's really good to have you here. My question is, how do we reach out to those communities that always seem to vote red? You know, they think we hate all Republicans. We don't have anything except to spend their taxes. How can we reach out to some of the rural communities to change their minds about how we see education, healthcare, to help them also?
I've been up in Mojave, and I say that because that is the reddest of our counties in the state, both in Kingman and then Bullhead City, talking to folks about the issues that that face Arizona related to education, and it's tied to economic development. What I hear from them, and these are both Republicans, Democrats, and independents, is that they are worried about the management of our economy into the next 5 to 10 years. And so I think that's where we have common ground. That's where we have, as Democrats, something to offer. We've not spoken as Democrats about being a party that wants to create opportunities for all. Sometimes we shy away from being a party that talks about, and individuals, leaders, that talk about the value of job creation, the value of opportunities here for Arizonans. And I think that's the common place that I've seen in the last 4 months since before I started the campaign, but more intensively in the campaign. So if that issue works in the reddest of counties in this state, I am sure that it works in other places here, but we've got to start having a long-term vision in order to do that. And my educational package, my reform on education, is led by Maria Harper Marinick, who was a chancellor of Maricopa Community Colleges. And what we are going to be introducing is a 10-year plan by which the end of the 10th year, every child in Arizona will graduate with a dual credential, with their high school diploma and an associate's degree, based off of one of the three verticals that we know we want to grow in. If it's technology, in medical, and in our hospitality, tourism-related fields, because of that's what makes up our economy. That's the type of vision that we need to work towards. And I think that's that gets us closer to providing a workforce that everyone can agree. You want to be successful where you live, but you've got to be able to attract industry there. And that will, I think, make us more competitive nationally and regionally. I think it's something that folks really resonate with, that message of opportunities for all of Arizona, no matter where you live in Arizona.
Thank you, Marco. We have a question from Craig Markin. Go ahead and unmute yourself, Craig.
What do you plan to do to address gun violence in Arizona?
Reforming our criminal justice system is something that needs to occur. I've asked Grant Woods to help lead that kind of group within my campaign, because it is something that is increasingly more problematic. I think over the weekend you saw a shootout, like a roving shootout of a gunman in the Peoria area. And there's examples of it almost every day on TV. Not always, of course, thank God, in Arizona, but it is a problem. And so we've got to address it. And I put together the work group to help us with achievable measures to help us curb and do that. But it all is also an investment in mental health and making sure that we have the resources available for folks that maybe show signs but of trying to reach out, but the resources of the state haven't been sufficient to properly address it in all of our 15 counties. And so I think there's investments in that area that we need to make.
Paul Wagerman has his hand up. Go ahead, Paul.
There appears to be a large field of Democratic Party candidates for governor emerging this for next year. How will you differentiate your candidacy to us loyal Democrats who are prepared to vote for the right person? And how do you make yourself known as the right person? Secondly, then, how can you then pull the party together?
Thank you, Paul. And I think that the question really is tied to one another. So first of all, I'm the candidate that isn't a politician that has actually created jobs and also will help build the coalition that helped elect Mark Kelly and President Biden in a diverse state. And so what I mean by that is the demographics that helped elect President Biden and Mark Kelly in the last cycle was made up of Native American voters, Latino voters, and rural voters. And so I've spent, since the beginning, our time and effort focused on how we engage those communities, which is why I'm visiting all 22 tribes. I've spoken to all of their leadership already, but I'm literally going to each one of the communities to meet with them and listen to them now, not 4 months before the election, which is typical of politicians, because their voice matters. And that's how we engage them. And that's how we excite them to turn out and vote for us as Democrats. And why and how we turn to your second part of the question, how we turn then quickly around to bring people on board who are independents or maybe former Republicans or even common sense Republicans that we need to win these statewide races. Remember, President Biden only won by 10,563 vote margin, plus or minus. And so our margins are very small. And so we've got our job of convincing is really big. And so I think that message of jobs, the message of opportunity, the message of making sure that everyone will be listened to, and I will lead for everyone, is the one that will help our party win. But Democrats actually make the gains necessary at the local and at the state elections, and also help carry Mark Kelly to victory. So I think that's the biggest difference between my candidacy and anyone of our Democrats, but Republicans as well, who actually has done the work necessary to create jobs, build an Arizona economy that's equal for all, that isn't a politician, and that will actually be on offense, like I've said before.
Shirley Muni, you've got a question. Go right ahead.
Hi, Shirley.
Parenthetically, if you're running for office, you're a politician by definition. But I'm going back to the criminal justice question that you had before. Would you address sentencing reform and also the huge private prison industry that we have here in Arizona?
Yeah, so look, my statements on private prisons align with President Biden's. We should not have a space where we have opened the doors for private industry to profit off of the criminal justice system. It's just not acceptable. I know that here in Arizona, these last administrations have gone wild And we've got to do what we can now to close down those leases or those agreements legally so that we don't get into trouble either, because obviously we don't want to be put in legal jeopardy as those taper off. And then on criminal justice reform, I think it's needed, but I'll wait for the recommendations of the committee. I'm not going to kind of supersede. They're the experts on it that are dealing with it as attorneys and judges and former attorney generals and so forth. So I'll wait for that recommendation, surely. And as a leader, I'll make the decision based off of what they recommend, and I'll be transparent and open as we go forward.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Shirley.
Our board member, Tony Zinman, has a question.
Tony.
Go ahead, Tony, and unmute yourself.
We've had a real bad issue with gun violence going on in this country. You know, it's become commonplace. You open up the newspaper, there's been a shooting. You know, we've had our share of it here in Arizona. Do you have any plans to reduce gun violence?
Yeah, so as I mentioned before, I think that it is something that needs to be addressed. You know, I'm a gun owner. I've been a gun owner since I was a small kid, going hunting with my father. And I think that there is a place, but there is a responsible place for it as well, with making sure that the right people are able to buy and sell guns, and that it's responsible. So, as I said, I think that there will be recommendations that that the state can implement, and those are the ones that I'm going to be talking about. But look, I believe in gun ownership, but responsible gun ownership. And we're going to make sure that the policies that do exist allow for that balance, responsible gun ownership and transfers in this state.
I mean, I appreciate the words and the vagueness, but what specifically, what concrete steps are you going to take to reduce gun violence in Arizona?
So as I mentioned before, I think that there will be an investment in mental health for those that are seeking help, that they don't turn to gun violence. And for guns, obviously the root of gun violence, there will be responsible ownership needed, and where you can buy and how you can sell guns.
Paul Wagerman has another question. Go ahead, Paul.
Assuming there is not a Democratic landslide up and down the ticket in 2022, how will you deal with a reactionary Republican legislature if it maintains that very narrow majority that it has?
Yeah, look, I think that there are practical things that can be done. I've worked with hostile city councils and hostile state officials since I was elected. I was 21 and everyone on my city council wanted to be mayor. And I got 97% of the time issues passed with unanimous vote. So look, it can be done. And at the legislature, if we have such a close margin, everyone can rally behind long-term vision. I think that if we are successful at articulating our long-term vision of success for Arizona, there should not be a reason why we can't get 3, 4, 5 people on the opposite side to come along. And let's assume they do not. I'm not shy about moving my office to whatever district that representative, that last holdout might be. You will see an active governor going out and meeting with that legislator's community as much as possible, because we've got to take, these issues are so important that we've got to take them out to the people, Paul, and not necessarily depend on the representative from that particular part of the state. You're going to see a very active governor going out there and meeting in their district, in those communities, to make sure that we're making the case why they need to vote on the side of what's good for Arizonans and good for that district.
Thank you. Thank you.
Dee Maitland has a question. Please go ahead and unmute yourself.
Marco, I'm sorry to bring you back to guns, but this is very dear to my heart.
Sure.
I would like to know that committee you have looking into it is looking at something completely different. For one, the Pew Trust has just put out an extensive study on gun ownership. Mm-hmm. There are 65% of Republicans own guns, only 25% of Democrats. So we are outgunned. Second, about 75% of all gun deaths are by males under the age of 40. So that gives me a couple of other approaches we should probably be looking at for trying to mitigate the violence. And third, I think that we're going to have to quit just bragging that we're gun owners too. I think you're going to need to say what kind of gun you have. And if I understand you, it's a hunting gun, not a multi-
That's correct.
Handgun, not an AK-47. So you're trying to be one of the guys saying you own a gun too, so you understand, doesn't work for me. So I just wanted to hope that you come up with something different, like banning guns by age or by sex or by political party, or let us be brave and confiscate AR-47s or whatever they are. We got to try something different. Okay. Sorry to give you a lecture.
Yeah, no. I don't disagree with your frustration. I just think that the realistic piece of what we need to do needs to include experts in the field who are working on this day in and day out, who are experiencing and who are victimized by this issue. And so for me to prematurely talk about their work and what I'm having them provide policy solutions to, I'm not prepared to do that right now. And so, but I do agree that we need to make sure that the folks who don't have access to guns that are used for violent acts, like the AR-15, has no place in our streets and should be regulated. I think those are areas that we agree on, but I'm not gonna tell you without a concrete policy behind it what you wanna hear. It's just not who I am. I wanna provide you and everyone with solid, concrete steps that we can take. And when we do that, you will be part of the conversation. And any feedback or any input that you have, this is why we're here, right? I don't have the answers to every issue on everything, but I want to make sure that I'm also accessible to you so that ideas and recommendations that you have are included.
Susie has a question. You're on.
Marco, it's not just guns that are injuring people. There was a truck that mowed down 9 cyclists in Sholo. Okay, there are other incidents where where people use their vehicles to injure others. This, to me, is a problem of anger, of unbridled anger for whatever reason. How do you deal with so many angry people? How do we mitigate this, elevated testosterone issue? I'm sorry, but most of these things are occasioned by men. Do you have any ideas?
Look, I think that part of what happened or what has happened in the last 4 or 5 years is that folks have been encouraged to express their anger, their hate openly. And so that's the job of leaders, is to figure out how we tone that down so that we see each other's commonalities where we can agree and not stoke the fears that every one of my opponents on the Republican side already started their campaigns with that fear, whether it be about the border, whether it be about criminals invading our streets. They've made a party, they've made a movement based off of fear and hate. And so when we see these acts play out, we kind of get surprised by them, because every time they are different, they're more grotesque and more violent. And so as leaders, we've got to find that common place where folks feel that they can express themselves without being violent. Look, every issue or we're not going to solve as government every issue or every fear that folks have or anger that they have or whatever issue it is independently that is motivating them towards that hate and that anger. But what we can do is provide the space or the help or the tools so that they feel that they can reach out to communities for that assistance. I don't think that we're doing enough of that right now, but it's inflicting communities, not only in Arizona, everywhere. So I don't have the magic solution of how we make people less angry and how we make them less volatile. But I think that that's part of this journey as leaders, that we've got to provide the space to listen, to talk to folks. And I said, look, I was in the reddest county and I'm listening to them and they're wandering around with Confederate flags in front of me. I'm not fearful. I want to listen. And so we need to also, you know, be open to that discussion instead of saying, yeah, you have a Confederate flag. I'm not going to listen to you. And so anyhow, I don't have a specific, Susie, to not have a specific proposal for you, but I think that that's all part of the frustration that we all feel about wanting to be more inclusive.
Well, thank you very much. You know, I'm glad you're thinking about it, and you are a better man than I, Gunga Din, for being able to sit in a room with Confederate flags.
Hear, hear. Andrea Kennedy, you're up next.
Marco, thank you for coming here to talk to us today. Actually, my question, which I really do have, is after numerous races where my candidate lost her governor and broke my heart, I got one of the answers as to why, as they don't know who he is in Maricopa County. We need to have Maricopa County to win the governorship. What is your thoughts on how to get the vote in Maricopa County and maybe along the way encourage people to vote Democratic so you won't have such a hard time when you're in the legislature?
Yeah, Andrew, thank you. That's a great question. One of my advisors for the campaign is Jim Messina, who ran President Obama's reelect. He's a good friend of mine and doesn't normally do national campaigns now, but because he's a close friend, he's helping me on this race. And specifically talking about what we need in Maricopa County to drive up those numbers in these communities that helped elect Senator Kelly and President Biden. And so this is why we have a 16-month runway. We announced in March to make sure that we're building those coalitions and that network that is required to win, not only in Maricopa County, but in all counties, because even though some of them are small, our margins are so small statewide that we do need the 500s or the 1500s or the 2000 vote communities to actually turn out in our favor. So I'm in fundraising mode since I started in March. And we're continuing that because at the end of the day, all words are good and great. But if we don't have the money to put out the message on TV, that is going to be very costly towards next year, we fail. And so that's why we've been doing this fundraising strategy since March. I'll be in DC on fundraisers later this week because it's got to be an effort from throughout the entire US. We're on a mission now to raise $20 million because that's what it's going to take to win this race. And there's not $20 million to be found only in Arizona. So we've got to work the entire country, Andrea, and that's what I'm doing.
Thank you.
Joe Danishevsky has a question. Go ahead, Joe.
Thanks. Marco, thanks so much for articulating a very...
Hi, Joe.
A specific position on many issues today, and also some great feedback. And you also strike me as someone who really takes some mental notes about what people are saying. And I really appreciate that as well. The question I have is, do you believe that in the state of Arizona, we have enough of a regulatory system for charter schools?
So look, I think the answer is no. I think that charter schools are good if they can compete equally with our public schools. However, I will tell you that Our first priority and investments need to be in our public schools. I'm a product of public schools. I grew up in Nogales, as I've said, and always went to and cherished the experience and the knowledge that I gained. And it just breaks my heart that 1,800 of our classrooms still don't have a qualified teacher. We're not taking care of the basics, Joe. And so a lot of it is our charter schools are incentivized for their owner to sell them off and make millions off of them instead of reinvesting those resources into quality schools for everyone, no matter where they are. 85%, between 85 and 89% of our kids still depend on a public school, and our investment needs to be put there first. So that's where I stand on that. And Joe, I'll also just let me say, I think that a lot of my experience has been carved around hands-on leadership and executive experience. I didn't have the luxury of not making a decision when presented with the facts at Homeland Security. I had to act because people's life depended on it. So my experience is nurtured by that, making sure that you're listening to folks and getting input from individuals with unique experiences, but ultimately the decision needs to be taken by me, the leader. And so I value the input because I think it makes me a better leader in being able to articulate the path forward for the next 10 years here in Arizona.
Great, thank you.
Let me ask you a question about voter suppression. You know, the legislature has just been on a tear enacting voter suppression laws, making efforts to kick people off the permanent early voting list. And meanwhile, in the U.S. Supreme Court, there's a case involving a third-party ballot collection, which the Republicans denigrate as ballot harvesting.
Right.
What specifically would you do to guarantee that everybody has access to the polls and a chance to vote without any burdens put upon it?
So first of all, if there are were any lingering bills on my desk, like I would immediately veto them. And then we need to get quickly to work to undo the damage that the legislature might successfully pass in the next few days that they've got left, or next year if they are successful. But the ultimate solution still lies in the For the People Act. And so that federally needs to be enacted. And I've called on that since I announced my campaign, because that is actually something that can help solve some of the serious assault on our democracy that's taking place. It's not a joke. We need to treat it as the serious nature that it is. But Republicans see that their future is dim as a party and as a leadership here in this state. And so instead of becoming more inclusive, they want to knock out folks who can and do want to participate in this cycle, hurting their dominance or their perception of political power. And so where that should tell us is that we need to double down and double up our efforts in registering more people and getting more people excited to come out and participate. Because that's all as citizens that we can do, is put pressure on federal representatives to act and pass the For the People Act, but locally, get more people excited and register more people. Do exactly the opposite of what they want us to do.
If you were governor, what would you be doing right now in regard to the so-called election audit that's been going on for months and months to try to turn over Arizona's vote in the national election? What would you be doing right now?
I would have ended it. I would definitely not look the other way like the coward of governor we have today. Every opportunity he's had to lead, whether it's been COVID, whether it's been voter suppression, whether it's been the border, every opportunity that he's had to lead, he's looked the other way like a coward. And so to expect that he would do anything different now is silly and ridiculous on our part, or on anyone's part who thinks he would act differently. And so that's what I would do. Take leadership, you know, an interesting word. I would be a leader in stopping before it got any wings. Sadly, I think we're well past that. And it does hurt me that on calls that I am with national donors, you know, the first or one of the last things they talk about is how silly and ridiculous Arizona has been looking because of this audit.
Yeah, no kidding. It's a Republican and right-wing tourist destination now. They come to Arizona and see what they can afford to ruin their own states. Barbara Warren is back. Go right ahead,
hey, Barbara. How are you?
The border issue is a huge challenge. Immigration is a huge challenge. There are many aspects of it. There are people in prison who shouldn't be. There are children who are not with their families. There are people coming across the border regularly and without support there's also a lot of legal issues that are being levied against people. So how would you deal with the immigration and the border issues, immigration in particular, in detail?
At the border, the asylum seekers who are showing up are not getting processed in a timely manner. And that creates additional hope for them to call up families. So we need to put the right investments in the system. I think, you know, and I know Ali Mayorkas as well. We served together at Homeland Security. And, you know, I share with him that one of the, downsides of them acting too quickly before being prepared to process the amounts of folks at the border is now costing us the goodwill that I think the president started off of, thinking that this would correct the wrongs of the last administration. So the investment needs to be made there, Barbara, to process individuals with respect, with dignity, but also the right resources for them to be able to have a hearing and make their case. On the DACA, I think it's tied to it. I think we need to, two things. We need to recognize them and give them permanent status. And number two, we need to be sure that they can pay in-state tuition. I think that'll be on the ballot and would encourage you to support everyone to support that, because they've gone through our education system. They're good students. And if they want to continue in our schools, they should be able to pay the same amount that an in-state tuition, an in-state student would. But it's the investments that we need at the border in immigration that needs reforming. And it's a matter of making sure that, again, Congress acts to update the 1986 system that no longer works. And I'll be an advocate for that, because I know that that's part of the problem that needs to be fixed.
We have time for one last question from Dee Maitland. Go ahead.
Since you are going to have to be raising money nationally, have you had any contact with our senator that doesn't want to get rid of the filibuster, because that's the only way we're going to get the Voting Rights Act passed?
I do share with them that that's between Joe Manchin and our senator. We need to make the case that on voting rights, the filibuster has no place. And so I'm encouraging of that. And these are donors to all major Democrats. And so I do make that case. But I don't know if she listens to you. She certainly doesn't listen to me.
Doesn't listen to me either.
Well, Marco, I want to thank you so much for spending an hour with us at Democrats.
Thank you all very much.
Greater Tucson. Before you go, please tell us how people can find out more about you and what people should do if they'd like to support your campaign.
Thank you, Larry, and I appreciate all of your time. It's a privilege and a pleasure to talk to Tucsonans. I was one of your own for 4 years while at the U of A, and I've enjoyed my time living and working in Southern Arizona. MarcoLopez.com is the place that you can find more information. You can sign up for our informational announcements and just watch that space on same at one Marco Lopez on Twitter and on Facebook. Follow us, learn about us. And as we release information, that's where you'll get most of the updates. But more importantly, it's about having a two-way conversation. And so please, Marco at MarcoLopez.com is where you can send your emails to me. I read them and I respond to them.
All right, Marco, thank you very much for coming to today's meeting. We wish
My
you
pleasure.
All the best. With that, we're going to have to adjourn, and I look forward to seeing all of you next week. Thanks very much.
Thank you all.